Do you smell it? That smell, that kind of smelly smell. A smelly smell that smells smelly. ABS? Yeah, we've all smelled that before. That sticky, sweet, plasticky smell that you get when you're printing with ABS. Common sense would tell you that that's not something you want to breathe. So now we all print more with ASA, which smells a lot less, if at all. But if you look into it, it turns out that ASA is often found to emit more harmful particles in box than ABS. So obviously, just because our nose doesn't detect something, it doesn't mean it's not there. PTG has no smell at all, but we've all seen that white powder that starts depositing on print heads even after just a couple of prints, so that's in the air. And even with PLA, there definitely is a smell. Just because it's cotton candy flavor this time doesn't mean it's just as good for you. Well, thinking about it, you know, cotton candy isn't exactly healthy either. And you know what? When I'm in the same room with a printer laying down PLA, I do get an itchy throat after an hour or so. That left me with a couple of questions. What are these 3D printers emitting that we're then breathing in? Can I measure and quantify the differences between filaments? How dangerous are these emissions? And what can we do to keep these emissions out of our lungs, our bloodstreams, and our brains? Well, this was a fun one to investigate. I built myself a sensor box, I did some research, I did some testing, and I've got some tips for what works and what doesn't. Right after a message from today's sponsor, Sunlu has introduced a new 14K red wax resin, which offers some interesting features for detailed oriented makers. This upgraded formula is designed to provide precise surface details and improve toughness, and promises to reduce shrinkage and cracking during post-print curing. The resin comes in a special matte red wax color, aiming to offer stronger light resistance and more visually striking prints. The 14K red wax resin is designed to be a low odor resin and can be safely cleaned in standard ethanol without requiring isopropanol. Sunlu has a wide range of resins and filaments, some of which I'll be using in this video, and if you're interested, you can find more info at the link below. So what are we looking at here? The two main types of emissions are particulate matter and VOX. Let's start with particles. You're all familiar with these, you know? N95 masks are essentially particle filters. They filter out at least 95% of all particles that are larger than 300 nanometers. Now, I was wondering as well, like, how does a filter only remove 95% of particles? Shouldn't this be an all or nothing question? Either, you know, a certain particle size is big enough to get caught or small enough to make it through. Well, while that is how filters work for coarser particles like dust, fine and ultrafine particles are absorbed in a different way. When looking at smoke and particles, usually you look at the size range of about 1 to 10 micrometers or 1,000 to 10,000 nanometers. And here particles are actually absorbed by colliding with the filter fibers and wedging themselves stuck. These are so fast compared to how big they are, they just wedge themselves into the filter. Now, you might think the smaller a particle is, the more difficult it should be to filter it out then. But with so-called ultrafine particles below about 100 nanometers, the particles actually start behaving more like a gas and show some Brownian motion. Basically, they're shaking around by themselves, so they are much easier to get caught by the filter fabric as well. Between these two ranges, 0.1 micrometers, so 100 nanometers, to 1 micrometers, is typically considered to be the hardest particle size to remove, so things like HEPA filters are actually rated on that size range. Now, why are particles relevant at all? The smaller they are, the deeper they make it into your body. Our respiratory system does a pretty good job of filtering out larger particles, but below 2.5 micrometers, they can make it deep into your lungs, and ultrafine particles under 100 nanometers can even make it all the way into your brain, where they have been linked to inflammatory reactions and an increased risk of conditions like Alzheimer's. So not something you want to be breathing in. The other category is volatile organic compounds. Think solvents like acetone, ethanol, benzene, formaldehyde. There's an almost infinite list of these, but all of them share some amount of acute toxicity to humans, and many of them also have long-term adverse effects when you're being exposed to them on a regular basis. So yeah, don't breathe this either. The standard way of removing box from your breathing air is by using activated carbon filters, which act like a sponge and physically absorb vox. And I'll be testing both particle filtering and vox removal later in the video. So to get at least some insight into what my printers are doing, I built myself this. You've seen these parts in the last video. This is an ESP32 based sensor array with two different brand VOC sensors, one from Sciosense and one from Bosch, a combined particle and formaldehyde sensor on the other side from Plantower, and a temperature humidity sensor for good measure. I've also got a couple more sensors on separate ESPs. One is a modded MQ7 carbon monoxide sensor, and I've also got another particle sensor from Nova Fitness running, as well as a second Sciosense vox sensor. Oh yeah, there's also a CO2 sensor in here, but these printers don't breathe, so that one didn't do much. These are all low-cost sensors relatively, so the particle sensors can't distinguish particle sizes under 1 micrometer. So we only get figures for smaller than 10 micrometers, PM10, smaller than 2.5, PM2.5, or smaller than 1 micrometer, which is PM1. That is still valuable information though. The vox sensors don't report on specific vox. Like I said, there are thousands of them, but they just give a total amount of everything they can sense. The Sciosense and Bosch sensors have different sensitivities to different vox, so that could be interesting. All of this is running ESP Home going into my Home Assistant setup. The initial outset for this video was to check whether enclosures can help with emissions. So that's why I'm now using my two printers that now have a full enclosure, the Magneto X with its acrylic panels and the XL with its bellows and hatch. I ran prints with PLA, PETG, ABS and ASA with the stock slicer profiles from either machine. Always running the same material on both printers at the same time, once with the enclosure open and once with all the doors and panels closed. And for all of this, I've had any filtration or ventilation turned off, both on the printers themselves, this one has a filter in it, and in my studio, I do have a ventilation unit and an air filter. So those were off for all these tests. But between the prints, I ran my ERV ventilation unit for at least an hour at full blast to get some fresh air in here and to get a fresh baseline. Each of these print sets was 120 grams of filament total between the part printed on the XL and the one printed on the Magneto. All the emissions value you're going to see are in concentration per cubic meter of air. My studio here, which is the entire air volume that these emissions are getting distributed into, is 50 cubic meters of air. So if you do the same test in a larger or a smaller room, you'd of course get lower or higher concentrations. So here's my data. I know this is pretty chaotic to look at, so I'm going to break it down in a second. Let me just show you what sort of a typical print looks like. This is one done with the enclosures open and with old ABS that's been sitting in the open air for a couple of years. Initially, you'll see a big spike in particulates. This is common for all these prints, as the first layer is typically printed a bit hotter, and at the typical print temperatures, every extra degree means a huge increase in emissions. Once that has dispersed into the room, there's a bit of a drop in particulates, and the slower accumulation in the air of both vox and particulates will take over, and within these 2 hours of the printers working, both of these concentrations will just keep on rising. Afterwards, the ventilation kicks on, and it actually takes a bit of time to fully flush my studio. It looks like I'm getting about a 70% air exchange per hour on the highest setting. To get some actual numbers, I'm only looking at the increase from the start of the print to the maximum during the print. And I'm also subtracting a baseline run with the ventilation off and the printers not running. For example, there's a lot of formaldehyde in the studio, actually more than what is considered safe for residential, and I get about a 20 microgram per cubic meter rise in 2 hours just by turning off the ventilation. I suspect that's coming from the resin corner over there, and I should probably do something about that. First of all, carbon monoxide. I didn't detect any amounts with any of the prints, which is good because carbon monoxide is something that gets generated in incomplete combustion scenarios. I was thinking if the filament undergoes some amount of pyrolysis in the nozzle, we should be seeing some amount of carbon monoxide, but we don't. Maybe that's something that becomes measurable at super high print temperatures past 300 degrees Celsius, but I didn't see it here. Then formaldehyde. I'm also throwing that out. There is something that I'm picking up, but the levels that I suspect might be from the printers themselves are so low that really they could be anything. Now, Where it gets interesting is with particle amounts. The amounts I measured for PM10, PM2.5, and PM1 were really close, which indicates that we are actually dealing with the more harmful, finer emissions. All those are inclusive, so PM10 also includes PM2.5, and that also includes PM1. I'm focusing on the PM2.5 here, because I can cross-check that between the two sensors, and because there are actual exposure limits that are defined that I can reference for PM2.5, while PM1 isn't widely regulated yet. Printing with ABS or ASA flew right past any of the limits for occasional daily or average annual exposures, no matter if I had the enclosures closed or fully opened up. That's pretty bad. Yes, this was with two printers running at the same time, but even if we take half of these values, ABS definitely still way too much. ASA, it still emits more than what's recommended by the WHO. The devilish part here is that ASA might still be worse than ABS. My sensors are measuring total particle mass per volume of air, while the studies that I've looked at measure the number of particles and their chemical composition. And compared to ABS, ASA was found to produce about twice the amount of particles that also contained more than twice the concentration of BPA, something that wasn't found at all in the particles from printing PETG. The acceptable daily intake of BPA is 0.2 nanograms per kilogram of body weight, which means that with the levels of BPA that the study found in the air when printing ASA, I would blow past the safe daily limit by just breathing normally for 3.5 minutes. So not only is what I measured in particle load in the air harmful, but also what's in these particles. And, you know, BPA is just one of the many compounds that can be found in these particles. On the other hand, when printing with PLA and PETG, I measured much lower levels of particles being emitted, and the levels that I got in the studio were within the generally safe limits. From what I found in the studies, at least the particles from printing PETG contain absolutely no BPA, while info on PLA is much harder to find, but I wouldn't expect it to be any worse. Now, moving on to VOX, there definitely is a measurable amount of VOX being produced by printing any of these materials, except for PLA. PETG did register on the cytosine sensor at roughly the same order of magnitude as printing ASA or ABS, while the Bosch sensor did not register any VOX from PETG, but a small amount from ASA and a larger amount from ABS. I don't know the exact composition of the VOX that each of these filaments produced. The sensors are just reporting a total and they have different sensitivities to different VOX. There might be some pretty nasty stuff in there, but at least the sensor readings themselves, even during printing, are much lower than what I measured in my living room in the weeks prior to moving the sensor box down here into the studio. So while I can say for sure that VOX are not something that you should worry about, at least when printing with filaments and not resin, they're not going to be as high up on my list of concerns. And before we move on to what you can do to reduce the amount of emissions that you're breathing, one quick side note on where those emissions are actually coming from, because it's not just the filaments, it can also be your 3D printer itself. One study found that the emissions they were measuring contained cycloxylanes, which is a component found in silicones and adhesives. So something as simple as that silicone heater mat glued to the underside of the bed assembly can influence what exactly it is that you're breathing in. So let's go over what works and what doesn't for avoiding breathing any of this. What definitely doesn't work is just putting the print in a box. I found no significant difference between prints done with the enclosures open or closed, but an enclosure can be part of a filtration or extraction system. Either one creates a negative pressure system where air from inside the enclosure is either routed straight outside or pulled through a HEPA filter and recirculated back into the room in a filtered state. I did a quick test with just a regular air filter from IKEA circulating the air here in the studio. I give it fresh filters and put it on the highest setting, and while printing ABS, it managed to drop the particle concentrations from unsafe levels to zero within an hour. Because it's only filtering the particles that are already in the air, that have already escaped, there is still that initial peak when the print starts, but the average levels are much lower. This also has an activated carbon filter, but because this is a comparatively small filter element, which means low surface area for the vox to wick into the carbon, it was much less effective at removing those and only dropped the levels by about 30%. Unlike particle filters, the only thing that makes activated carbon more effective is having more of it. Because if you just increase airflow, you're also proportionally reducing the time that the air is in contact with the carbon. Even Alveo 3D, the company making the filter unit for the XL, makes no specific claims for how necessary or how effective their activated carbon filters really are. Proper commercial carbon cartridges have a couple of pounds per cartridge of activated carbon in them, and on top of that, they're being used in bundles for a reason. I'm also not sure how well these, tiny air filter products work. You're supposed to put these inside a 3D printer enclosure and just have them circulate the air inside there, but because the air can still escape everywhere else unfiltered out of the enclosure, and you're not creating that negative pressure in there and forcing the air through that filter, I don't think these are going to be particularly effective. These have even less activated carbon in them than the IKEA filter, so that's all that's in this particular one. And this one also doesn't have any sort of particle filter at all. Activated carbon vox is not something that I'm super concerned with these filament printers, but yeah, just keep in mind, these are very situational. If you just want to filter particles, I think the most universal way is just grabbing an air filter, air purifier, whatever you call them. IKEA makes these now. These are 30 bucks regular. I got it on sale for 20. And they have the same EPA 12 class filter as the bigger one. And EPA 12 means each time the air passes through this, 99.5% of all particles are getting removed. And that's really good. I'll link some more on Amazon below. The other thing that you can do, and this is a compromise, is you can just print colder. Yes, layer adhesion will suffer, but interestingly, one study shows that right at the normal print temperature of ABS and ASA, every single degree of temperature difference makes a massive difference in the amounts of particles emitted. I also tested whether filaments needed to be fresh to get minimal emissions, but in practice, there isn't actually much of a difference. Old PTG did register more vox than fresh, but that might actually just be the specific filament they used. In general, just use common sense. I mean, as blatant as that is, most particles get emitted at the start of a print, so don't stick your nose in there. I mean, I know it's tempting, I do it myself. And just because you're not smelling anything doesn't always mean there's also nothing being emitted. But the opposite is true. If you can smell something, then there is definitely something in the air, and with ABS that tends to be a pretty good indicator. So if you can make do with PTG and PLA, those seem to be a much less harmful alternative to ABS and ASA. I'll be much more careful with sharing the room with a 3D printer from now on. And this air filter is gonna live in here and it's gonna run in here until the motor burns out. While the testing that I did probably isn't totally up to the scientific standards you would expect, just like the actual papers, it does show that there is something going on and we simply don't have the long-term knowledge yet of what effect that's gonna have. If you're interested in the sensor box I put together, check out the description for parts and the ESP home config. Stay safe out there, keep on making, and I'll see you in the next one.